Hi everyone and welcome to OGLDEV. My name is Etay Meiri. In the previous episode, we got a shader framework up and running. And today we're finally going to see some action on the screen, some movement. We will do this with the help of uniforms. They are a critical mechanism in the operation of shaders. We're basically going to use them all the time. So let's get started. Here's a diagram of a programmable stage and I'm using our current vertex shader as a reference. We have the original position from the vertex buffer coming in from the left-hand side. That's the input to the shader. On the right, we have the output. Let's call it the transformed position. The shader code is in the middle. On every invocation of this shader, we get a new vertex with a single attribute, a position vector. Now, what if we want to multiply the components by something other than half? Does that mean that we have to create a specific hard-coded shader for every calculation that we plan to do? Obviously not. This will never scale. Therefore, we need to make that half a parameter of the shader. So instead of multiplying directly by half, we will multiply by, say, x, and then we just need to supply the value of x to the shader before the execution of the draw call. Once the draw call has been completed, we can change the value of x, and in the next draw call, the shader will multiply the vertices by the new value. This is where uniforms come in. Uniforms are input data to the shader, which remains constant throughout the execution of the shader in every given draw call. I like to picture uniforms as if they are coming in from the side. The vertex attributes that are going from left to right are like a highway of data which keeps changing, yet the uniforms remain the same. We're going to need a few matrices to perform 3D transformations in the upcoming videos, so we will store all of that stuff in uniforms. Now, let's see the mechanics to change our variable from hard-coded to uniform-based. Let's start with the vertex shader code this time. We have a new variable here called gscale. Its type is a floating point, and you can see that the storage qualifier, which is the token that comes right before the type, is a uniform. We've already seen the storage qualifier in for the vertex attributes, and out for the color in the fragment shader. So uniform is the third storage qualifier. This tells the shader compiler that it needs to allocate some space for this variable with a size that matches the type, and that the application is probably going to put something there. If you don't initialize the uniform variable, if you forget to do that, then the system will initialize it to zero, so at least we have some consistency here. The gscale variable replaces the hard-coded half from the previous tutorial, so now we multiply the x and y components of the position variable by gscale. That's it for the vertex shader. Nothing has changed in the fragment shader, so let's see the changes on the application side. But before we jump to the CPP file, let me just say that we need to bind the GLSL uniform to a C++ variable in the same way that we bind a vertex attribute to a structure in a vertex buffer. There has to be some index that synchronizes these two elements. I could have used an explicit binding as we did with the position, where we specified layout and location equals to zero in parentheses, but I want to show you a more flexible method where we let the compiler allocate the index and have the application query for that index. So in the application, we need to call glGetUniformLocation in order to get that index. The first parameter to this call is the program handle. The second parameter is the name of the variable in the shader code. Note that GLSL is case sensitive, exactly like C, so make sure you use the exact same name. Valid indices start at 0, so if there is an error, the system will return -1, and it's important to check for errors, which is what we do here. Another thing which is critical to remember is where to place the call to glGetUniformLocation. The compiler will allocate the indices to the uniforms at link time. This means that if you call this function before glLinkProgram, you will get an error. Let's see an example. Let's move this section before the link program. Now let's try to build and run. And here we get an error. So anywhere after the link is fine. Also remember that once the index has been set, it will not be changed. So it's best if you query for the uniform location once for every uniform in your shader and then store it somewhere. For example, as a class member if you're using C++. This way you don't need to call this API in your render call. You know that the overhead to that stored variable in your application is very low, but calling glGetUniformLocation can incur an unknown overhead that may change between drivers. In this tutorial, I simply save the uniform location index right here in the global section. Here. And the last thing to remember is that if you define a uniform in the shader and you don't use it, it is considered inactive and the compiler will not assign an index to it, so naturally you won't be able to get its location. We have established a link between the uniform in the GLSL code and the index in the C++ code, so the next step is to populate the uniform with data. We will do this in our render callback. I created a couple of static floating point variables here because I want their content to persist across multiple calls to this function. We have the scale that is initialized to 0, and the delta which is initialized to 0.005. We add the delta to the scale, and once the scale crosses the value of 1, the delta is reversed. And then when the scale crosses minus 1, it is reversed again. So the scale bounces back and forth between minus 1 and 1. Now we want to send the value of scale down to the shader. We do this by calling glUniform1f with the index location that we got by calling glGetUniformLocation and the value to pass in the second parameter. This function handles a single floating point value, which is what we need. There's a whole set of similar functions to handle 2D, 3D, and 4D vectors as well as matrices. We will start using these when our shaders become more complex. The last thing we need to do is to make sure that we have a call to glutPostRedisplay right here at the end of the render callback. This tells glut that it needs to call our render callback again and again in a loop, otherwise it will only call it when there are events from the windowing system or keyboard or mouse. Now let's build and run the code. Remember that all my tutorials have a directory according to their names and each directory contains a build.sh file that you need to run in order to build the code. So that's the basics of using uniforms. I hope you enjoyed this episode and found it useful. In the next one, we will start looking at the 3D transformations. I will break it into several videos, which will cover the entire process of going from a 3D scene onto a 2D window. So thank you for watching and I will see you soon.